Praise God. Praise God. And let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, the Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exhort, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to talk about prayer, a wonderful topic, very central to Christianity. And it's going to be a two-part series. So we are going to do part one today. And if the Lord tarries, we finish it next week, in next week's lesson. So the topic for today is how to pray, part one. How to pray, part one. And the case study will be Lord Jesus Christ, Christ and the disciples. And short reading, yes, a short reading is going to be Matthew chapter 6, verse 9. We start at 10, very short this week, huh? Matthew 6, 9 to 10. But before we go any further, let us pray. Father, we want to say thank you. You are so beautiful. Thank you because all the powers are in your hands. And you do not misuse your power, even though you are not accountable to anyone. Only you can be God. And so, Lord, we ask that you open our eyes through this lesson to teach us how to pray, to know how to pray aright, so we can get answers. Thank you, Father God, for in Jesus' name have we prayed. Amen and amen. The foundation text is Epistle of Apostle John, 1 John chapter 5, verse 14. 1 John chapter 5, verse 14. If you are a Bible student, you are saying that already. It says, now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Amen. So what is the Lord's prayer model for his followers? That story is back in the gospel according to St. Matthew. And the disciples, they came to Jesus. It was in the infancy stage, so to speak, of their discipleship, learning from the Lord. And they said, Lord, teach us how to pray. And Jesus said, this is how you pray. So we are pulling that prayer that is popularly called the Lord's Prayer. And we are going to break it down. And we are going to be using the principles of that prayer to be asking God when we pray, maybe for finances, for spiritual growth, for marital situations, children's problems, whatever it is, the principle remains the same. Amen. So what is the Lord's Prayer model for his followers? Number one, alliance. Our Father, which art in heaven. The Lord's Prayer opens with a collective possessive noun. Our Father, you see. This shows that whoever is praying this prayer belongs in God's family. Got it? You can call somebody a stranger. You can call them your father or your mother. They won't take it because that's a claim that doesn't belong to them, you see. It also shows that whoever is praying is lesser in position to God, you see. That's why Jesus didn't say our friend which art in heaven, or our mate which art in heaven, our body which art in heaven, or our politician which art in heaven, you see. Because all these people, you can talk to them anyhow, you see. But when, if you are well trained, well brought up, you don't talk anyhow to your parents. No, you see. The relationship between the person praying and God is none other than that of a father and child. And that doesn't mean that God is physically a man. No, God is spirit, the Bible says, okay? But he's using these attributes of being a father to give us an imagery of what he does, his characteristics, his responsibilities for us, okay? A father protects his family. A father provides for his family. If any father is derelict in those areas, we call them deadbeat. We call them all kinds of names, you see, because they are not supposed to leave their families unprotected or unprovided for. So for God to use, to call himself a father, he's not saying I'm a man, even though he uses that pronoun, but it's God is spirit. Amen. So this prayer model pinpoints where this father lives in heaven. If the God you pray to lives anywhere other than heaven, is not the God of the Bible. He's a false God. Amen. This prayer model demonstrates to us that God is the head of a big family that has countless number of children across racial and gender lines. Listen, if you are looking for someone who speaks to the specifics, is Jesus Christ. Jesus will tell you one sheep got lost. He will tell you, I'm sending you out in twos. You see, he will give you specific numbers. But when he doesn't give specific numbers, he's telling you it's innumerable. You see. So by Jesus saying our Father, he's telling us his children are countless and they come from all nations and from all races. Amen. So if you are having problems with other races and other nationalities and you call yourself a Christian, now you know that you need to fall on your face and ask God for forgiveness. So therefore, for anyone to confidently proceed in prayer, they must be convinced that they are a child of God through the blood of Jesus and in good fellowship with fellow believers. When you are fellow believers, you don't see color, you don't see accent, it doesn't exist. It's the same Holy Spirit. And I'm taking my time to build this foundation because this is what it's all about, all right? The individual must also be convinced that the God they are praying to is the God of the Bible, who is known to live in heaven. So you must be in God's family, which means you have been saved. You must be in good terms with your fellow believers because they are your brothers and sisters, regardless of their racial or gender lines. Doesn't matter. Okay? So let's go to Gospel according to St. John, chapter 8, verse 55. John 8, 55. Yet you have not known him. This is Jesus replying to the Pharisees now. But I know him. He's talking about the Father in heaven. And if I should say, I know him not, I shall be a liar like you. But I know him and keep his saying. Listen, if you are indeed a child of God, in the family of God, you will know who your Father is. You will know his story. You will know his character. And you will obey him. To know his story is to know your story. The only way you can know your father's story is through his letter to you, the Bible. If not, somebody may come and knock on your door and give you some mumbo-jumbo story, and they will sweep you away in their heretic teaching. So know your father's story, because to know his story is to know your story. Moving on. Reverence. So we don't only come to God knowing our alliance with him and with other believers. We also come with reverence. Protocol. Protocol is the next thing Jesus taught us in this prayer model. Hallowed be thy name. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. This shows we must approach God with thanksgiving. Think of the many things he has done for you and proceed before him from that standpoint, you see. If not, you'll be a grumbler and a murmurer, you see. And God doesn't smile on people like that. You cannot go to see President Donald Trump in flip-flop and spaghetti straps and torn jeans. The Secret Service won't let you come in. It doesn't matter who you are, because you are not following the protocol of appearing before the President of the United States. Now, we are talking the President of all presidents, okay? God Almighty. Even though he's our Father, there's a protocol. There's a way we appear before him. And we come before him first with thanksgiving. Does this mean God needs to be propped up? Absolutely not. Oh no. Thanksgiving is for our own good. It reminds us of who we are praying to and how big our God is. Hallelujah. This in turn will minimize the problems that could have followed us into his presence. As a result, our spirit will become calm to hear how the Holy Spirit wants to guide us in our communication with God. Let's read Psalm 100 verse 4. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Hallelujah. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. To be ungrateful to God is to be distasteful to God. Jesus healed 10 lepers. Only one came back. And Jesus said, didn't I heal 10 people? How come it's only one that came back? You see, the other 9, they were distasteful to him. So don't be distasteful to God. To be ungrateful to God is to be distasteful to God. Moving on. Prominence. So we move from alliance to, reverence. And now we are talking prominence. Thy kingdom come. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. This is teaching us about what should be our utmost desire in life. So before you bring your spiritual prayer request, your family prayer request to God, remember these principles, okay? Your utmost desire concerning that prayer request is that the kingdom of God comes. To ask for God's kingdom to come is to pray, listen up, for the Holy Spirit to direct our lives instead of us doing the directing. Got it? We all need a lot of work to do in that area. Right now, listen up. The kingdom of God has not come on earth. You only need to watch the news and then you will know. Right now, the kingdom of God is not yet here physically. However, every child of God can bring the kingdom of God down through a Christian walk. By so doing, we can expand the kingdom of God to whoever we come in contact with, you see. As a child of God, when your utmost desire lines up with the kingdom of God, with the word of God, whoever comes in contact with you will know that you are not an ordinary person. They will know you are different, you see. And by doing that, they may not change and be converted to Christianity, but you have deposited something into that life. You have expanded the kingdom of God. It's possible to be a saved child of God and still have your own kingdom in your life. This is called carnal Christianity in the Bible. A carnal Christian is one who has refused to let the Holy Spirit have dominance in their life, you see. When I first became a child of God, I was a carnal Christian because I won't just let you go. If you have been watching me for some time, you will know I'm a spitfire. Praise God. But God made me a spitfire to be able to preach the gospel, you see, not to fight with other people or to say something bad to my husband. No, you see. So I had to begin to, when I started reading the Bible, I noticed that the fire began to go down, you see. And I was beginning to hear the Holy Spirit more. And God began to mature me, you see. 2 Corinthians 12:20, we are not going to read that, gave us a snapshot of a carnal Christian. Let's see a quick snapshot. They engage in quarreling, jealousy, rage, rivalry, slander, gossip, arrogance, and disorder. If you cause trouble in your church or in your house fellowship, Bible group, listen, you need help. You are the only headache that your pastor has or your Bible leader has in your group. You need help. You need to fall on your face and ask Jesus to help you to move from being a carnal Christian to becoming a maturing, growing Christian, you see. So as we pray to God, we should ask him what way will my prayer bring an expansion to the kingdom of God on earth. If the answer is no, because as a child of God, you have the mind of Christ. So you can actually answer that question yourself, that how is this prayer request going to expand the kingdom of God? If you are going, drop it. Pick another prayer point. Pick another prayer request that you can pray on, okay? Because you want to pray and be sure you are praying the will of God. Romans 14:17, the book of Romans chapter 14, verse 17. For the kingdom of God, and I picked this one from Pastor Chastandy, God's rule over a believer, that's God, that's the kingdom of God, is not meat and drink, but righteousness. That's God's transformation of a believer, you see. And peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. If your prayer request is not right, if it's not going to bring peace to you and to the people around you, if it's not going to bring joy to you and to people around you, listen, there's no point wasting your time. Cancel it out and pick another prayer request, because you only need to pray in line with God, with God's word, and boom, you see answers. God will answer, he has promised. To pray for a wrong reason is to pray for a long season. Joseph and Zion, stop. You will now say that bread on the go again, because somebody has been arguing in their mind inwardly as we've been preaching that I don't think prayer works. Look at me. Prayer works, okay? Prayer works because our Jesus is alive. This is the problem that has been making your prayers to be unanswered by God. Listen up. To pray for a wrong reason is to pray for a long season. So make sure your prayer lines up with the word of God, and then write me a letter or send me an email. Say, I tried what you said, and this is my testimony. Amen. Moving on. Obedience. So we started from alliance, our Father, which art in heaven. Then we went to reverence, hallowed be thy name. Then we came to permanence, thy kingdom come. And now we are talking obedience, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. This is talking about our obligation, our indispensable duty as a child of God. As believers who have been redeemed, bought and paid for by Jesus with his precious blood. It is our duty. Let me say that again. It is your duty, it is my duty to obey the Lord's direction at all times, in all things, no exceptions. That's it. Case closed. The world is not doing the will of God right now. Have you watched your television today? Do I need to say more? The world is not listening. The world has gone crazy, you see. And Jesus is not expecting the world to bow to him for now. Listen, this makes me smile. The world is going to bow down to Jesus one day. Oh yeah. Mohammedans, Buddhists, Hindus, everyone, atheists, Hollywood, they are going to bow their knees to Jesus one day. Oh yeah. But not right now, okay? However, the burden of obedience is for God's people only for now. We are to obey God's instructions as they are obeyed in heaven. Listen up now. There is no dissident or resist party in heaven. Oh no. The one who tried it is who we now call Satan. His name before was Lucifer. Lucifer was a beautiful name. But when he tried to cause rebellion in heaven, he was kicked out with one third of the angels, who we now call demons, you see. And his name changed from Lucifer to Satan, you see. So there's no resist party in heaven. Forget it. So therefore, we are expected to pattern our lives according to the submission found in heaven. Jesus called his true disciples sheep. Listen up. Sheep are not stubborn like goats. Oh no. They do not have horns to push back like rams. Have you ever seen a sheep with horns? That would be abnormal, because they don't. They have no teeth to bite like dogs. Have you noticed that? So therefore, a true child of God will not repeatedly disobey like a stubborn goat, nor shove divine instruction aside with horns of indifference like a ram. A true sheep of Jesus will not bite into pieces divine instructions like a dog does meat to selectively hear and obey. A true sheep will not do that. A true sheep of Jesus Christ will take all the instructions from the Word of God, hook, line, and sinker. That's it. You don't argue. You take it. It's the Word of God. We should always remember this prayer model in presenting our petitions to God. We need to prepare our hearts beforehand to agree with and obey the Lord's instructions, no matter what. You know why? Because God, I love the way Dr. Rogers said it. He said, God will choose for you what you will choose for yourself if you had enough sense to choose it. I like that. I like that. So whatever answer God gives you, it may not be to your taste or to what you are expecting. That is the best. Okay? James 1:25. The epistle of James, chapter 1, verse 25, it says, but he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. You want God to answer your prayers, like one of my sisters in this ministry will say, that someone has a hotline to God in heaven, the thing you prayed for before I got home, it has been done. You see, you want to have a hotline of prayer to God in heaven, then obey his word, everything, and you'll see him come through for you. Obedience is the ingredient for resilience against the devil's advancement. Listen, if the devil has been advancing against you, the moment you start obeying the word of God, that advancement stops right there. Obedience is the ingredient for resilience against the devil's advancement. So what have we done so far? What is the Lord's prayer model for his followers? Number one, alliance. This is to identify a relationship with God and with other believers. Reverence. This is to start a prayer with thanksgiving. Prominence. This is to allow God lead the way and to direct us. Obedience. This is to accept whatever answers God gives to our prayer request and fully agree with his instructions. For us believers, if you have been saved, you are a blood-washed child of God, the high priest and the apostle of our confession, Christ Jesus, has left us a model of prayer to follow. So don't say, I don't know how to pray anymore. No. When I talk to people in the ministry, and a lot of times they're like, I don't know how to pray. Oh no, you can pray. Just follow these principles, okay? The Lord taught his disciples this prayer when the disciples were just beginning their walk with Jesus Christ. While it is not unbiblical to recite the Lord's Prayer, I recite the Lord's Prayer myself. However, the Bible encourages us to become mature, to grow, you see, and eat the meat of the word. When you are just starting out as a believer, you can be reciting the Lord's Prayer. That's okay. But as you are maturing, take the principles and apply it to other areas where you want to pray about, okay? Any believer who struggles in knowing how to pray can apply these principles of this prayer model concerning any prayer request they may have. The Lord's Prayer, however, is not for the unsaved. So if you are yet to believe in Jesus, you're unsaved. This prayer is not for you. Why? Because you are yet to make God your father, you see. Jesus Christ is not yet your big brother, you see. However, God is willing to adopt everyone who is ready to confess that Jesus is the Son of God. If you can say Jesus is the Son of God and you believe it in your heart, Jesus is ready to adopt you and make you one of his own. Like he made me, you see. Like he made many of our brethren all over the world, you see. God is ready to adopt anyone who asks for forgiveness. You need to recognize that you're a sinner because we were all born in sin. It doesn't matter if you have never stolen or killed anybody in your life. It doesn't matter. By crooked DNA of Adam in us, we've all been compromised. But when you ask God to forgive you, he will, okay? And the blood of Jesus will cover you. And then you become perfect before God. If you ask for Jesus to save you, he will save you. He has promised he will never say no to such a prayer. Oh no. Mm-mm. No matter how vile or grievous the person's sin may be. So don't say, oh, I've done so many bad things. It doesn't matter. Just call to Jesus. He is ready to save you. If you are ready to say that simple prayer, I'm going to say a quick prayer and a link is coming up. Follow that link. We will meet you there, all right? Father God, in the name of Jesus, thank you for adopting us into your family, for making us your children. And Lord, even as we apply these principles from the prayer model that you gave us, may we begin to see results in the name of Jesus. Grant us, O Lord, the opportunity to share testimonies with one another. And for those who are going to want to know Jesus' page, to become adopted by you, Father, open their hearts, give them the understanding. For in Jesus' name, I will pray. Amen and amen. I'll see you next week, and we'll complete this next year, if the Lord tarries, okay? If Jesus has not split the sky open.